Hello, BookTube. It's Terry from Terry Talks Books. I am here to continue my wrap-up for January by talking about another single book that I think deserves some attention. And that book is Nectar in a Sieve by Kamala Markandaya. I think that's how you say it. Not absolutely positive. But this is a book that was published in 1954, and the author, this is a bit of a pseudonym she's using here. Her name is Kamala Pranaya Taylor. She was born in 1924, and she died in 2004. She was an Indian novelist and journalist. She was born in India and educated at the University of Madras in India, and then emigrated to England in 1948, where she met her husband. I'm assuming he was an Englishman. I think I read somewhere that he was an English journalist. So while she was there in England and doing some journalistic work, I think that's where she met her husband. And so she lived in London with him. I don't know how often she went back to India, but she lived in both places, but definitely Indian born and raised before she moved away, apparently sometime in her 20s. This is a book that I had not heard of until Rainy from Rainy Day Reads, I will link her below, until I heard her talking about this. It was a vlog, one of her videos from sometime last year, probably the middle of the year. I can't even really say, but she mentioned this book. She was reading it. In fact, she was rereading it and mentioned she never heard anybody talking about this. And she had read it in college as part of an Asian literature class. And she just described it fairly briefly, but it seemed to mean a lot to her. And between that and her description, I thought, you know, it sounded like something that I should read. And I was a little bit curious that it's something I'd never heard of. I've not heard anyone talk about it. And when I go on to Goodreads, I don't see most of the people I interact with. I don't see that any of them have entered that into their Goodreads. So I was a little bit curious too. I get that way. So I thought, you know, this is something I want to read, something I think I want to read. So got a hold of it, and instead of losing it somewhere on Mount TBR, I decided to read it right away. It didn't take too long. It's not a very big book. This is actually a mass market size that I'm holding, and I can't remember the page numbers, but I think it's under 200 pages. Let's see here. So that's just a little bit about the author and why I decided to read it. The story, there's not a lot of plot per se. You know, things happen and you're kind of curious what's going to happen, but it's really, again, about characters and the life of these characters. And, you know, any plot that is there is just to add to, you know, the characters and their lives and what we know about them. So the book opens as Rukmani, an elderly Indian woman, who is also the main character. She is recounting her days, and it starts out, within the first page, we find out, we get started on the story with her as a young child bride. She was married off at the age of 12. She was the youngest daughter of four daughters in a family that I didn't get the impression that they were wealthy, but they were not poor. They, you know, lived a fair life. So the older daughters managed to marry fairly well. But by the time we get to the fourth daughter, there's no dowry money left. And so she is married off to a tenant farmer at the age of 12. Her husband is a good man. I mean, this could go, you know, a different direction, but her husband is a very good man, and he loves her, and we follow their lives as they raise a family amidst sometimes real, just grinding poverty. They have very high hopes, you know, of owning the land. You know, he's a tenant farmer, but you know, being able to work hard and then own that land and just improve their lives over time. But as anyone who works the land knows, you know, small farmers and such, nature can be very fickle. And that life is a very hard life. And just when you think things are going to go well, they just absolute devastation happens. So this is pretty much their lot in life. Of course, we see the births, deaths, relationships, as we would expect in a novel like this. So, you know, as I'm telling you about this, you know, it doesn't sound very exciting. And really, it's not an exciting book. That's not the point of this book. There's something else that that the author is doing here, and I'll talk a little bit more about that as I go. What the author does not do in this book is she doesn't focus on the fact that Rukmani was a child bride. So she doesn't really, short of mentioning it, and you know, this happened. There's not really commentary on it, and she doesn't dwell on that. It's not, you know, looking back, Rukmani looking back on her life, thinking, you know, oh, if I'd not been married off at 12, you know, I was just a child. It doesn't go in that direction. It's just a fact. She was married off at the age of 12. The other thing that the author does not do is she does not dwell on politics, especially colonialism. And the time period of this is somewhere around the time when India gained its independence. So often when you read books from, you know, this time period and by Indian authors and others, you know, that the focus would be on that, on the politics and on, you know, the evils of colonialism and all of that. Well, she doesn't do that. She doesn't ignore it. She doesn't really sweep it under the rug, but just she doesn't focus on it. She doesn't dwell on it. And in that, she is very much like her character, Rukmani, who seems to just roll with whatever life gives her and continues to hold out hope for a better life, and doesn't dwell on, you know, the evils of such things as, you know, colonialism. So I thought that was kind of interesting, because I've read a few other books, and definitely that would be a great part of the focus and the story. Like I said, we do see some of the results of colonialism, and we see that namely through a character, the character of Kenny, who is a white doctor, and I'm assuming he's British, but you know, I don't know. It's never, his background is a bit of a mystery. Pretty much we know that he's white, and I'm assuming he's probably British, but he could be American. Really don't know. But he's like many people, he's an interesting blend of kind of good and bad. He's kind of a frustrating mix. I wanted to know more about this character. I never really got much more. He seemed to have a very gruff personality, yet he had a very big heart. And he seemed to be there to help. And I think, you know, this is just me and my thinking, I'm thinking that in this character, we're seeing somebody who in a sense represents colonialism, but as he's an individual, he's not, you know, a big business coming in, because that does happen also in this book. But he's an individual, and he's constantly frustrated by, you know, in a sense, he wants to, as a colonialist, you know, he wants to make things better, and he's frustrated by the poverty and the injustice that he sees, and his inability to understand the fatalism and the people he's trying to help, and you know, how they don't stand up for themselves. He's using very Western ideals and ways of thinking amidst these people in India that he's trying to help. So I thought he was a very enigmatic character. He was very interesting. So in a sense, he represents colonialism, but I don't know as though I want to say this, but is there a good side? You see an individual who is honestly trying to help, and he is a doctor, and he does help. Often, he does help, but one man can only do so much. So we see that reflected in him. We also see colonialism reflected in a big business that moves in, a tannery moves in, and it just changes the entire culture, the life of the people who live in this village, the way the community functions amongst each other, you know, the relationships amongst the various community members. It really changes things, and it sets, in a sense, it sets up, you know, the younger generation against the older generation, who, you know, they want to see if they can do better, and there's this promise of life being better if they join this Western way of living. And so it's the commentary is there by just presenting these things and making them part of the story. But other than that, again, the author doesn't focus on it. It's just an integral part of the story. Let's see. I did talk about a character of Kenny, because I wanted to talk about two characters, or highlight two characters that are not Rukmani, the main character, but Kenny, and I pretty much talked about him. And what I didn't say is that his relationship with Rukmani and her family is lifelong. So he was not a fly-by-night, you know, person. He came and he went, and that was mysterious as well. And it seems to me like maybe he was off trying to raise funds so he could come back and, you know, build a hospital, things like that. But we don't know that. We really don't know that. And but his relationship with Rukmani and her family goes back to when she was a child. So, and then another character that deserves a mention is, I was just kind of, it surprised me. A little boy named Puli, I think that's how you say it, P-U-L-I, is, he's just right out of a Dickens novel. He's a little street urchin. Our character of Rukmani and her husband, in their old age, find themselves in a city, a larger city, and they do not know how things work, and they're taken advantage of, and they really just want to go back home, and their luck just keeps, they just don't seem to have any, and they're, you know, they're old, and this young child, who is a child, but who has street smarts. He's wise in the ways of living in a city and having nothing. He comes to their aid. And it's a very interesting relationship between he and Rukmani and her husband, Nathan. His name is Nathan, the husband. I don't think I'd mentioned that. Let's see. Yeah, He was a great character, and we don't see a lot of him. He, you know, for most of the book, he's mentioned at the very, very beginning. We don't even know his name, but he remains a mystery, and he doesn't show up until the latter part of the book, when we find out who he is and how he becomes a part of Rukmani's life, Rukmani and Nathan's lives. So, overall, what do I want to say about this book? First of all, thank you, Rainey, for bringing this to my attention. It was just a beautiful, beautiful book. It's a seemingly hopeless book story. I kind of emphasize the word seemingly. The hopelessness, there is hopelessness, but our characters don't go that route. Rukmani especially, and Nathan as well, is there's always tomorrow. There's always a chance. We'll just you know, here's what we'll do. We'll make a plan. And even though they know that their plans are always being, you know, destroyed, they never seem to lose hope, even in very, very hopeless situations. So it is hopeless. There's a lot of hope and fear. There's a lot of beauty, even amidst destitution. And I mean destitution. This is not, oh, you know, I don't have the things I want. This is literal, you know, starving to death sometimes and having nothing. So the author still writes a story in which there is beauty amidst that. And that would take some skill, I would think, to be able to do that. Our main character, Rukmani, I would describe her, she's a survivor, she endures, but most importantly is this woman just has the deepest compassion for others. And it just, I think that's a part of why she can have hope and see beauty even amidst all the hopelessness and the destitution. The novel itself is very timeless in the way it's presented. I think the author helped that along a little bit. She was very ambiguous about, I kept thinking, how did I miss the time setting for this? Exactly where am I? You know, I mean, I know I'm in India and I know I'm probably mid 20th century. And other than that, I'm not absolutely positive, but I think it takes place somewhere around the independence of India within like a 5-year window of that. But since we cover her entire life, you know, I'm not sure where we begin and where we end. So that's rather ambiguous. And that seemed to me somewhat intentional on the part of the author because she had something more important. And because of this, I think this is a book, people should still be reading this book, really. And I think Rainey would agree with me. People should still be reading this book. And if they knew about it, I think they would. The writing, I want to comment on the writing. There is, it's quite lyrical. I'm going to put this down for a second. It's quite lyrical especially when the author is writing about the natural world. And I marked a passage that I want to read that represents that. It's not very long. So if you don't like being read to, it won't last long. For in the town, one walked with care for what might lie beneath one's feet or threaten from before or behind. And in this preoccupation, forgot to look at the sun or the stars, or even to observe they'd changed their setting in the sky, and knew nothing of the passage of time save in dry frenzy by looking at a clock. But for us, who lived by the green, quiet fields, nature still gave its muted message. Each passing day, each week, each month left its sign clear and unmistakable. I thought that was very beautiful, and she has many passages like that where she captures truths. They're universal, again, timeless, and they just have a beauty. I mean, you could bring that forward to now. How many of us, you know, most of us live in big cities, not everyone, but many of us live in big cities, and we get wrapped up in running around and the franticness, and you're trying to watch where you're stepping. You're watching out for cars, and you're watching out for this and watching out for that, and you never even look up at the sky. You never look at the trees or the flowers. You know, you don't notice these things. You know, you just look at your clock. You don't know what time it is. You're inside. You're working in an office. You don't even know if it's light or dark outside. You don't know what time it is unless you look at a clock. So, you know, again, the timelessness. I mean, I could see that. I could just see that now in me and people I know and the world I live in. So, there's one other passage that I thought spoke to this idea of the land and poverty. And that is, to those who live by the land, there must always come times of hardship, of fear, and of hunger. This is one of the truths of our existence, as those who live by the land know. that sometimes we eat and sometimes we starve. In our lives, there is no margin for misfortune. It made me think back to a book I read recently, Prairie Fires, about Laura Ingalls Wilder. And she presents, the author of that biography definitely presents this idea, the novels made, the books, Little House books made, made this look romantic, but the reality of living off the land was quite different. So anyway, I really hope that a few of you might pick up this book. And I think it's like rainy. I think it's one that I'll reread maybe multiple times throughout my life. So I encourage you to read this. Let me know what you think if you do. Talk to you later, BookTube. Bye-bye.